Good morning students. So today we are going to learn all about the scheduling, right? So in this tutorial we will be learning what are the scheduling objectives, on what basis the CPU takes the decision of scheduling, the two types of scheduling, that is preemptive and non-preemptive, and what are the differences between both this preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling, and what are the different criteria of scheduling, right? So let us begin with. Now in the last tutorials I have already mentioned that all resources must be scheduled before they are used, and we have already discussed there are different resources in our system, such as CPU and the input output devices. Now when you try to schedule the CPU, the work is done by the CPU scheduler, and the process of allocating CPU to process is known as CPU scheduling. Short term scheduler is another name for CPU scheduler. The main reason why the CPU is to be scheduled is that so that it could be fully utilized and the CPU will be busy. And as is mentioned on this slide, there are two types of scheduling, preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling. I have also mentioned here some examples. We will be learning all about this scheduling in the coming tutorials. For example, preemptive scheduling example is shortest job first, and the example for non-preemptive scheduling is first come first served. Now let us try to understand on what basis or what are the conditions under which the CPU scheduling decisions take place. There are four conditions. First condition is when a process switches from running state to waiting state. In the earlier tutorial of process states, we have already discussed what do you mean by waiting state. Waiting state happens when a process waits for the completion of an IO request. Second condition occurs when a process switches from running state to ready state. In the ready state, the process is waiting for the CPU. It is not waiting for any external IO request, but since other process is running, it has to keep waiting in the ready state. Third condition occurs when the process switches from waiting state to ready state. Again, here it is not waiting for any IO request, but it is waiting as some other process is running. And the last condition is when a process terminates. So depending on one of these four conditions, CPU scheduling takes place. Now next we are trying to understand what do you mean by preemptive scheduling. Preemption means what? Interruption. So if a process is interrupted to stop its execution and allow other processes to start execution, is called as preemptive scheduling. Now here, if in a system a higher priority process enters it, then the current ongoing process will be halted and the new process will be given a chance for execution. And since it is interrupting the system, less number of processes gets executed. Now here for our understanding, we have taken one example. Here four processes are there and each of the process arrives at this particular moment, and their CPU burst time is mentioned, means how long it will take for completion. And here I have mentioned the priority for each process. Now here note that lower number means the process has higher priority, and higher number means the process has low priority. Okay, so now since the P2 process has entered the system first, it will start executing. But after 1 second, say suppose another process, that is P3, has entered the system and it has higher priority than P2, then it will be given a chance for execution. So the P3 will be executed completely. Till that time, P1 and P0 has already entered the system, but since P0 has higher priority than P1, so the next process that will be executed after P3 will be P0. So after completion of P0, next in line P1 will be executed, and finally the remaining P2 process will be executed. The reason why the P2 was executed last was it was having the lower priority as compared to higher priority. So this type of scheduling, in which a process, if it is currently going on, but if a higher priority process enters the system, then it will be interrupted, and this type of scheduling is known as preemptive scheduling. Now next we are going to discuss what do you mean by non-preemptive scheduling. So here, opposite to that of preemption, non means it will not allow any interruption. So the process, current process, will continue even if higher priority process arrives. But it may happen that it may wait for some IO request, or it may terminate in itself. Okay. So this type of scheduling is not suitable for real-time system, as the system may have some urgent need, may have some urgent process that needs to be executed. And due to this non-interruption, large number of processes gets executed. Now here I have taken the same example to illustrate the concept. Again, our P2 arrives first, okay, and it has the lower priority. But see here how they are executed. Since P2 has entered first, no matter even if higher priority process comes up, still it continues till its completion. Then the second process that has entered the system is P3. Hence, it will be given chance next, even though some other processes have already entered the system. So it does not matter what is the priority of the process. The processes will be executed as per their arrival time. And this type of scheduling, in which there is no preemption, means no interruption, is called as non-preemptive scheduling. I hope you have got this concept. Now let us understand the differences between preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling. Here, in preemptive scheduling, a process switches from running state to ready state, or it may switch from waiting state to ready state. Then in preemptive scheduling, multiple processes can run. That means, like in the earlier example, P0 was interrupted, some another process was executed. So similarly, multiple processes are executed. And to enable this preemptive scheduling, specific hardware is required, and this type of scheduling was actually used in Windows 95. Now let us consider non-preemptive scheduling. In this, the only thing that happens is either the process switches from running state to waiting state. Waiting state means what? It will wait for some IO request to be fulfilled, or it may get terminated. And once the process is allocated to CPU, it will complete its execution till the termination. Already in the example we have seen, and since it executes linearly, it does not need any specific hardware, and this type of non-preemptive scheduling was used in Windows 3.x. Now next we are going to discuss the scheduling criteria. So first criteria is CPU utilization. Every system is designed in such a way that the CPU should be fully utilized, means from 0 to 100%. So this is the first criteria of scheduling. Second criteria is throughput. Throughput means how many processes get executed in particular amount of time. If the number of processes executed are more, means the system has more throughput. Or another way you could put it up like this, amount of work done by the CPU. Third criteria is turnaround time. Turnaround time is the time difference between submission of a process and completion of process. Another way you could put it up like this, turnaround time is equals to time on waiting queue plus time on IO request queue plus time required for execution. Means the moment till the process enters the system and the moment till it gets its completion. So the difference between submission and completion of process is called as turnaround time. Next criteria is waiting time. This is the sum of the waiting time of the process in the ready queue. Ready queue, it is not waiting for any IO operation, it is only waiting for the attention of the CPU. Next criteria is response time. This is the time difference between submission of job and the first response time. Understood? I hope you have understood what doing by scheduling. Thank you.